And God is so good to us. So good to us. Would you look over at your neighbor and just tell your neighbor, said, you know, God's good to you. Well, y'all need a little bit of excitement about y'all. Y'all are as dull as the days are long. Man alive. Hallelujah. I wouldn't want the Holy Ghost. Hey, God's been good to you. My Lord put some feeling into it. God has. How many can say God's been good to you again? Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated. It's a privilege once again to be back here, like I said. So good to have Brother and Sister Patrick in church with us today, and my wife, and Brother Patrick and from Conroe, and so good to have them today. They drove down here this morning, and I appreciate it. I hate for the reason why I'm here is because of what happened, and Sister Maez and Romy and all of them. I hate that so bad. Hallelujah. But like I said yesterday, it's all in the hands of God. God knows everything. I don't know everything, but God knows everything today. Hallelujah. And I'm going to preach to you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want the Holy Ghost to have its way. And there's no telling what God's going to do before it's over with. Y'all may ship me out real quick. You know, never know what God's going to do. And but God's in the place today. Hallelujah. So good to see Brother Newsom this morning. And I went by his place yesterday hoping that he would be out there and by the church, and he was. Good to see him. So good to have Rose this morning in church with us. This is Jerry's sister. And so good to have her. I went by and saw her mom dead yesterday, and so good to see her. She told me she would come be in church with us today. So good to have her. Good to have all the rest of you here. Hallelujah. And I want to tell you something, and I want to read a scripture first. Genesis, the 18th chapter. And while you're turning there, Genesis, the 18th chapter, verse number 14. It's good, once again, to be with Brother Bumgarner. I appreciate him, the invitation to come and preach here today. I do. And very much. And enjoyed Brother Backus this morning. Enjoyed your worship this morning. Good to see Sister Waddy turn loose. My goodness alive. Hallelujah. I was holding her mute while she was shouting. Hallelujah. So everything's fine. Praise God. Genesis, the 18th chapter, verse number 14, says, is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. And I want to preach to you for just a little while. Is there anything too hard for the Lord today? Now, you say you got a need.
Come on, come on.
You say you got troubles. You say you got pain, and you got this and you got that. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? And before I get started today, I want you to notice, who is this speaking? It's God himself. It's not a man speaking to him, but it's God speaking. He said, is there anything too hard for the Lord? Can you lift your hands? Let's go to God and pray. Ask God to anoint one more time here today. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And may the Lord bless you. You may be seated. It's so good to see all of you. Some of you men are beginning to wear suspenders, and that's good. And Brother Baumgartner showed me his yesterday, and Brother Keith showed me his, and different ones were showing. You know, at least I did rub something off on you. Nothing else. Hallelujah. But is there anything too hard for the Lord? All of you know that about 4 years ago that my son Chad had to have a kidney transplant. You all know that Brother Mark was the one that donated the kidney to Chad. And just lately, we found out that Chad's going to have a kidney replacement again. And the doctor told him the reason why was because of when they put the kidney in, and they put that saddle, whatever they call it, on your arm, that they did not give you any blood thinner. And all that blood went to your fingers, and all it clogged and become like clay, and it couldn't flow. And that's the reason why that they had to take your fingers off and all of that. And Chad was very despondent, didn't realize he was going to have to do it. More despondent, and that was the fact that he knew that Mark was the one that gave the kidney and all of that. And so he was very despondent. And the doctor told him, he said, but this time, he said, it would be different. He said, I will see to it. He said, the doctors that did this was 2 years behind in the medical part of this. And that's the reason why. And so they were going to give him another kidney. And it said all the infection from those fingers went to that kidney without them knowing anything about it till later, to now. All that went to his kidneys and the infection, all of that. From that, and that's why the kidney was bad. And there's a lady from Pine Bluff that her and her husband just moved to Whitehall in Arkansas. And she told us that she was on her way from Tyler. They lived in Tyler. They just moved to Whitehall. And they were originally from there when they first got married about 18 to 20 years ago. And they moved back there. And she said that, told me, and I told my wife first, said she was driving back from Tyler, from taking her grandkids back from spring break. And said when she did, she said, the power of the Holy Ghost moved into my car, and the power of the Holy Ghost began to move upon me. And said the Lord, said if I've ever heard God speak, said God spoke to me. And the power of the Holy Ghost told her, said I'm going to renew Chad's kidney. The words that they used, the words that she used, I'm going to restore that kidney. Now, you, sister, you know anything about the, they tell Chad, and they told us that there's when his kidney failure, there's nothing they can do about the kidney. There's nothing that can be done. She said, I pulled over the side of the road. The power of God on Interstate 30 was so powerful on me. She said, I pulled over to the side of the road, and I began to talk in tongues like I've never talked in tongues in all of my life. And said, the Holy Ghost spoke to me again and told me, I'm going to restore that kidney. She's not the only one of lately. Sister Owens, a lady that's been in the church for a long time, has told my wife. She prays for us every day, and she'll text my wife and let her know that she's prayed today. And she said, I want you to know, God is going to restore the kidney. And you look at me today and you say, Brother Fisher, my Lord, that's something for anybody to step out on a limb like that and say God's going to do it when doctors say there's no way. Y'all didn't hear me. I said the doctor said it can't be done. Whew, my God, have mercy. But is there anything?
Come on now, go ahead and say it.
Too hard for my God today. Hallelujah. I said, is there anything too hard for God today? There's needs in this service, and I felt it just a little while ago, that before this end, we may be here at 2 o'clock, 3 or 4 o'clock.
That's all right.
But God wants to do something for somebody today that really needs a touch. And you don't believe, hey, and they say there's no way. They said it can't be done. Listen, God does not go by your age. Hallelujah. Is there anything too hard for him? And I got to thinking about that. And Lord, you know, and I can say, well, God, there's no, every doctor says it can't be. And honest to God, God's come to me several times lately and said, is there anything too hard for me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Brother Newsom, God said there was nothing too hard. Nothing too hard. In Genesis 1:1 said, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Goes on down to talk about how that God separated the darkness from the light. God put the stars and the moon all in place. God did. The fowls of the air he created. And reached down and took the dust of the earth and made man. God did. And the Bible said that God breathed into man's nostrils and man became a living soul. And from Adam's side, he took a rib and created woman. Is there anything too hard for God? Church, if I myself, and I'll say about the ignorant one in this building today, but if I could ever get it through my brain, God created him. God made. Hallelujah. And is there anything too hard for him? The Bible talks about Abraham, and this is who he's talking to. Abraham and Sarah. He told Abraham before he ever left his country, I'm going to make a great nation out of you. And the Bible said later on, he told him, said, hey, Sarah's going to conceive and have a son. And all of a sudden, they begin to laugh. And God said, Abraham, is there anything too hard for me? Yes, God, she's 90 and I'm 100. So ladies, don't give up yet. I'm telling you what. I've never seen so many babies in all my life that I've seen it going on around yesterday and today. Babies everywhere. Hallelujah. God said, is there anything too hard for me? It doesn't matter how old you are. God does not go by age. We do. We're the one that judge things by age. God doesn't. God said, I told you it's going to come to pass. Have a son, and now I will return. Hallelujah. 10 or 9 months later, wow! You know what that meant? There was a kid born. Hallelujah. 90 and 100 years old, and my mind and your mind says it's impossible. But we serve a God that says there's nothing that I cannot do. Hallelujah. Can't you imagine what it was like? In a few days, Abraham looked around and he looked at Sarah and said, honey, you're looking sharp. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. You say, well, that's hard to believe. But did you know later on it talked about the king? So and Abraham lied and said Sarah was his sister. Now I'm going to tell you something. I don't know of any king that would want a 90-year-old woman. But he looked at Sarah and he really liked her. And he took her to be one of his wives. Then he found out Abraham lied to him. So that let you know that God was working. All right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother, I cannot think of his name right, from Minden, Louisiana. He didn't believe that we should have to die with disease or sickness and all that. He said, I believe that that God just lay down and go to sleep. He said, I believe that's the way it ought to be. That we not disease and sickness and pain and all that, and just lay down and go to sleep. And he preached that, and he believed that. Hallelujah. Because there was nothing God can't do. Hallelujah. You've got problems today, but hey, there's nothing God can't do. Jacob and Esau had a problem between themselves. And Jacob knew that if Esau would kill him. But the Bible said, hallelujah, there was no way around it. But the Bible said he got on the hillside and he got along with the Lord. And he wrestled with an angel to the breaking of the day. Hallelujah. He said, let me go. He said, I can't let you go, not till you bless me. Hallelujah. And God gave him what he wanted. Is there anything today too hard for God? And when they met one another, they embraced one another. Hallelujah. Don't tell me today that God can't do it. Don't tell me this morning there's nothing God can't do. I know God can do anything today. And God, I want to convince myself more than I want to convince you this morning. There's nothing that my God can't do. You talking about revival in Wharton, Texas? If this church would get to the place that walk out on a limb and said, hey, there's nothing my God can't do. My God can heal. My God can do anything that he desires to do. Nothing. Nothing that God can't do. Hallelujah. Joseph, hallelujah, had a dream. Hallelujah. Joseph, hallelujah. Would you believe that Joseph was put in a pit, sold as a slave, went to prison, and later on he became the ruler? There's nothing God can't do. I don't care how dark it looks, how bad it looks, there's nothing my God cannot do. Hallelujah. I feel it bubbling inside of me so strong right now. Hallelujah. I get right here where the action's at. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Go ahead.
Hallelujah. Nothing God can't do. Hallelujah. You know that? Yeah, nothing. Moses, lead my children out of the land of Egypt. God, I can't do that. He said, I can't speak. He said, I'm going to give you Aaron. But he also said, Moses, who made the mouth? All you timid people hear this. Who made the mouth? Moses said, well, God, you did. He said, if I made it, I can feel it. You know what God did? He led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. And he came to the Red Sea. Hallelujah. And God told Moses, and stretch forth the rod. Because Egypt was coming behind them, and there was mountains on both sides and the Red Sea in front of them. And when he did, the Bible said the waters departed. The sea parted. Y'all still hadn't grasped that. I mean, yeah, that's wonderful. That's just great. Look, I'm not bashful. I'm going to tell you just like I feel tonight. Hallelujah. Moses, then I heard a man one time make the same. He said, I don't believe it took, I just don't believe that happened. He said, I believe it was just a little old stream, and they all went across on the stream. And the man that was telling him the other way, he got to shouting. Just, man, he began to tear up Jake. He said, what are you shouting about? I told you I didn't believe it. Man, he said, you just made a bigger miracle than what it was. To believe that God, hallelujah, could take a little stream and swallow the Egypt army. He said, you just made it bigger than what it was. Is there anything too hard for God? The Bible said they got on the other side and they began to rejoice. But the next day they had no water. They began to grumble and begin to complain. And the Bible said he spoke to Moses and said, Moses, hit the rock. Speak to the rock, excuse me. And he hit the rock, and when he did, water came forth. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Just why dig a well when you can just hit a man? Why dig a well when you can just talk to it? Hallelujah, little rock. Hallelujah. And the Bible said later on, they didn't have no bread, nothing to eat. Manna fell from heaven. That is just wonderful. Boy, I wish y'all could see yourselves right now. Hallelujah. When I'm talking about a God that you claim that dwells on the inside of you, and you can sit there and just be so calm about it. You say you got problems and there's something on the inside of you today that you can lift your hands and say, God, I believe you today, Lord. There's nothing that you cannot do, God. Looks like you guys are the only one who believes me right here. I'm going to have to preach to y'all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Nothing. Y'all still hadn't grasped this yet. Didn't have no meat to eat. And quail. You hunters, I want you to learn to pray the quail in instead of having to go out and look out behind the bush and everything. And they prayed. Hallelujah. And God let it fall in their midst. Is there anything too hard for God? They wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. A cloud by night, day, and a fire by night. God did. You don't realize who you serve today. You don't realize the power that you have today. Hallelujah. I'm talking about a God, Sister Waddy, that said he could do anything. You ain't created a problem that God can't solve. You don't have no sickness that God can't heal. My God. Is there anything too hard for him? Well, there's nothing too hard, Elder. You believe what I preach as much as anybody that does. There's nothing God can't do. Nothing. God don't go by age. You didn't look younger than your wife. I mean, you don't go by age. Hallelujah. God's still the healer today, isn't he, Brother Daniel? God's still here. When the doctors thought he wasn't going to make it, he said, hey, it's him, not you. It's him that says, I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it. Hallelujah. Church, let me tell you something today. There's nothing tonight or this morning that my God cannot do. Hallelujah. Nothing. Joshua! Now hear me now. Y'all hear me?
Come on.
Son, stand still. In the middle of a battle, sun was running. I mean, time was running out. The sun was about to go down. And the Bible said he asked God to let the sun stand still. And the sun stood still. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Can you imagine what it's like? For the sun, and science has proved there's time missing, and it goes back to when Joshua asked God to let the sun stand still. She just read my mind. I said, there'll be people running the aisles here today. I'll be people shouting, worshiping God. To know that you serve a God like that. Hallelujah. Jericho. Hallelujah. God said, walk around it once a day for 7 days. On the seventh day, he said, you walk around it 7 times. And he said, the walls are going to fall, not down, flat. It's like this floor. It was just that flat. He didn't have to stumble over. No, for them, they fail. The Bible said they marched around one time, two times, on the seventh day, three, four, five, six. And he said, after you go around the seventh time, shout!
Yes, sir.
And they shouted. And the walls came down. Hey, honey, it was so thick you could take two chariots and go around it. But when God's in the middle of it, honey, there's nothing too hard for my God today. There's nothing my God cannot do today for you. God have mercy. Hallelujah. Gideon, 32,000 men. And after a while, it was, God said, you got too many. Well, but God, you hadn't seen the enemy yet. You got too many men. You know the story. Won't go into all, it got him down to 300 men. And God fought the battle. They killed one another getting out of camp because they heard about Gideon. Oh, my God. Hallelujah. I'm coming. I promise you, I'm coming. Hallelujah. Samson! The Spirit of the Lord came upon him because he was in the wrong place. He shouldn't have been there to begin with. But the Spirit of God came upon Samson. The Bible said he walked away with the gates of the city.
Yes.
Now, I know we got some big guys here today, but we ain't got nobody like that. The Bible said one day Samson was in the field. 1,000 Philistines came at him. He reached down and got a jawbone of an ass and slew 1,000 Philistines. I'd do good to kill half a man. Not even, I couldn't kill a whole one, let's more than 1,000. By the time you get through wrestling with one man, you're tired, you give out. But you think about 1,000. Is there anything? Hey, this is not fairy tales, honey. This is true. Is there anything your God cannot do today? Hallelujah. There's nothing today. Look at your neighbor and say, there's nothing my God can't do.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Y'all would never convince me the way you said it. There's nothing my God can't do. If you want to convince somebody of it, if you're convinced with inside of you, hey, you look at somebody and say, hey, there's nothing my God cannot do.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. The Bible talked about David. The Bible said his brothers were all in a ditch. And David stood up and said, who's that uncircumcised Philistines? What? They pulled him back. And boy, do you know who you're talking about? That's Goliath. And you see how big he is? You know what? David never saw how big Goliath was. All he could see was nothing but God. Wouldn't it be good today if we as Pentecostals, the only thing we could see, nothing but God. The world says this can't happen, that can't happen. I don't see nothing but God. I got news for you. There's nothing God cannot do today.
Lord, magnify the Lord.
Hallelujah. But it gets down to Elijah. Got down to Elijah. The Bible talked about how that Elijah was on the mountain and he challenged the 450 prophets of Baal. I told somebody the other day, and I mean this with all of my heart, I told my church Sunday night, and I mean this. What happened to prophets today that's ready to stand up before this world? The world is saying that nothing, don't mention Jesus. The media today says don't mention nothing about Christianity. Don't mention nothing about Jesus. What about prophets today that'll stand up? I challenge you.
Come on.
Let God be God. Let me go a little bit further. I challenge Peace Tabernacle today. Let God be God. God in this sanctuary. When you walk inside, said God, you be God. You be God. But it's sad that we live in a world today, and you hear me good. We as Pentecostals, we have set back, and we let every other denomination fight this and fight that, and we set back with our hands folded. Hallelujah. And we don't disturb nobody. Apostle Paul, 4'9", took age and turned it upside down. Just a hunchback. Soul running eyes. But that didn't stop him from being what he was. Hallelujah. He said, there's nothing my God cannot do. He said, I've been through it all. I know there's nothing God can't do.
Yes, Lord.
All of this that took place with all these things that happened to Paul. Hallelujah. And yet there was nothing that God can't do. Elijah challenged them. He challenged them. I'm telling you what, I'm sick and tired of sitting back. We sit back, let one woman take prayer out of school. And I might get in trouble, but if I get in trouble, it's not you, it's me. And I'll testify to it in court. We've sat back and let the gays run things. Rush Limbaugh said there's only 3%, 0.3% of people in America that are homosexuals and all of that. And yet we let them march. Yet they can do what they want to do. And somebody said, well, I'm just going to say, that's what's wrong today. Hey, we need people that will stand up and tell the truth and say, hey, I know what my God can do. I know the God that I serve today. Honey, if you believe the other way, you're in trouble anyway.
Amen. Amen.
That's all right. That's all right.
I'm not ashamed to say it.
Come on. Come on. That's all right.
My God, hey, God give us boldness in these last days. Hallelujah. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Job lost everything that he had. If God strips you of everything, hallelujah, you still can lift your hands and say, but God, there's nothing you cannot do. And God restored double what he had.
Yes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Is there anything too hard?
Yes, Lord.
Ezekiel, can these bones live?
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Prophesy to them.
Speak it.
And when he began to prophesy, the bones begin to connect. Neck bone to the bone, and now all begin to connect to one another. God asked him another question. And again, Ezekiel said, you know, Lord. And flesh came upon the bones. Ask him another one. A wind blew, and the breath came into those bodies. Is there anything too hard for God? You look at me today as if I'm telling you fairy tales. I'm not telling you fairy tales today. I'm telling you the truth today. I'm telling you about a God that's real. Y'all hang on. I still got a little ways to go today. I'm going to finish it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What would you be saying if you was in the middle of a lion's den? What would you be saying? I'd be saying, Cleo, get back. I'd want a stick. I want a shotgun. I want anything I get a hold of, wouldn't you? Yeah, I thought you would. Hallelujah. You got to have them. I'd get a hold of them. But you know what? But Daniel went into the lion's den. Hallelujah. You know the reason why he did? Because he knew there was a God that could do anything. I'm going to tell you something. Did you know the Bible said that Daniel was there when it became law? Daniel was standing right beside the king when he took that ring and put that ring to that paper which made it, which sealed it as law. Anybody caught praying to anybody beside the king would be thrown through the lions? Daniel was there. Had faith, that's right. And he trusted God. Hallelujah. And when he was thrown in, and listen to this. When the king left him, he said, hey, Daniel, hey, the God that you serve, he'll take care of your wife. But it wasn't Daniel's word, it was the king's word. Daniel went to sleep. The king sat up all night long. Because Daniel said, there's nothing my God can't do. You know? Hallelujah. And no doubt the Lord told those lions, said, listen, you got a guest coming today. His name is Daniel, and y'all be good. You take that fur and make him a good pillow, a good bed. You understand me? Hallelujah. And next day, the old king comes, Daniel! The God that you serve continually, is he able? He said, live forever, O king. He's able.
Amen,
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said, my God that we serve is able to deliver us. But if not, we're still not going to bow down. We're still not going to worship your God. Hallelujah. Throw him in the furnace. They threw him in the furnace. When the fire got down low, all of a sudden the king said, did we not throw three in there? He said, yes, I was Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He said, we may have thrown three, but there's a fourth one that's just like unto the Son of God. Hallelujah. That's walking in the mist. Nothing God can't do. I'm taking you all the way through the Bible, so just hold on your seat here. I want to prove to you something today. Hallelujah. There's nothing God can't do. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Did you know the last time that Mary spoke in the Bible, when she told those servants, said, whatever Jesus says do, you do it. Well, because she just heard they didn't have no wine. And she told Jesus, and Jesus said, well, what do I have to do with this? And then she just turned to the servant and said, whatever he says, you do it.
Hear the word.
Mama knows more than anybody. Yeah, Mama ain't crazy. Mama knows stuff. Mama knows. Hallelujah. All of a sudden, Jesus looked around and said, go and fill those pots up with water, or vessels with water. And when they came back and they began to pour it into the vessels that they were going to serve as wine, don't you know those boys that put water in there said, our head's going to roll. Our head's going to roll. My head's going to roll. My head's going to roll. The only difference, they had probably would have rolled, but it was Jesus that told them to do it. And whenever the king tasted of the wine, they said, oh my, you have saved the best for last. Hallelujah. Brother Fisher, are you sure that God can do? Hey, there's nothing that God cannot do. Nothing my God cannot do. Peter, my goodness alive, in the midst of a storm, my goodness alive, the boat's about to go down. Uh-huh. They go to the bottom of the boat, and they didn't know what's going to take place. And they said, Master, do you care whether we perish or not? And the Bible said Jesus came. I mean, the wind was blowing, the lightning was, it was a bad storm. He walked out of the bow of the boat, and he said, peace, yes. Be still.
Yes.
Yes,
sir.
Yes,
Lord.
What kind of man is it?
Mm. Yeah, they asked the question, when Jesus passed by them and let them know you have a little faith. And they said, man, what kind of man is this that the elements and everything obey him? And some of you are sitting here today and you said, what kind of guy is this? What kind of man can do that? And yet you don't understand the Holy Ghost. You that's got the Holy Ghost dwelling on the inside of you.
Preach the word.
Come on. Yes,
hallelujah. What kind of man? Hallelujah. He goes on a little bit further. Listen to this. He goes on just a little bit further. And the Bible said he gets to the place where a man is in, he went to the other side. And there was a man that was possessed with demons. Got on the other side. And the Bible said when Jesus came ashore, the man ran to him and fell at his feet. And Jesus said, "What is your name?" He said, "My name's Legion, because there's so many in me." And Jesus cast them out. Honey, when Jesus walks in the room, there is no fight. When the Spirit of God is in the place, honey, there is no fight. Hallelujah. Is there anything God cannot do today? Anything. Set a man free that was lived in the graveyard. Nobody wanted to be around him. They chained him and everything else, and he broke the chains. But is there anything too hard for my God? He ran and fell at Jesus' feet. Anything too hard? Anything too hard? Hallelujah. Praise God. Blind Bartimaeus. What's that noise I hear? I mean, what's all the ruckus about? Never mind. You wouldn't be in. They're not interested in you. And he kept getting, and he got louder and louder. He said, "Who is that? What is that?" And somebody finally said, "That's Jesus of Nazareth walking down the road." In other words, the healer's coming down the road. And he cried out, "Jesus, that son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus kept walking. He called out the second time. And then finally he called out the third time, "Jesus, the son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus said, "Bring me that man." And when he got there, he said, "What is it that you want?" He said, "Lord, that I might receive my sight. I'm blind, blind." And Jesus just looked at him and said, "Go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole." You know, it's easy to pray for somebody with a headache. Woo, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But what about the cripple? What about the blind? Is there anything? If God can heal me of a headache, God can heal the blind. He can heal the blind. Nothing God can't do. Hallelujah. I said there's nothing God can't do today. One more time, when you look at your neighbor, there's nothing my God can't do.
Nothing.
Little woman, is your blood? She cried out. My wife's looking at me like I'm going too long, but I got to finish it now. I'm telling you right now.
Come on, keep on preaching. We're used to it around here. Come on.
Little woman, is your blood? Did you know historians say there was about 150 people that was around Jesus when blind Bartimaeus was healed. But he doesn't record anybody else getting healed. And not only that, did you know he never passed that way again? So you better cry out while you got a chance to cry out. Little woman, is your blood? All of a sudden, everybody was around Jesus so tightly around she couldn't get in. But in her mind she said, "If I can but touch the hem of his garment, I know that I'll be made whole." Hallelujah. Oh my God. What would happen? Let me keep reminding you what would happen at this church if we ever got in that frame of mind. If I can but touch him, I know that I'll be made whole today. And I know the revival will break out. I know that my kids will pray through the Holy Ghost. I know that my husband will receive the Holy Ghost. If I can just but touch the hem of his garment, I know that God will do it. I know that God will do it. Jairus' daughter, hallelujah. You talk about a God that I serve. The people come and said, "But Master, don't bother him any longer. She's already dead." And Jesus looked at him and said, "Just believe. Everything's going to be all right." When he got home, everything was fine. Anything. No, there's nothing God can't do. Nothing that my God cannot do. I'm hurrying today. There's nothing God cannot do in this service today. Hallelujah. When you look around and when Jesus had taught them for a long time, the Bible said they had no food. And Jesus sent his disciples and they found two fish and five loaves. And the Bible said that he said, bring it to me. Hallelujah. Oh, my Lord, Lord, there's so many people, 5,000 men, and not counting the women and the children, but how would two fish, five loaves do it? He said, bring it to me. And he began to break it in his hands. God began to break it. As Jesus began to break it, the Bible said they passed it out. And then everybody, when everybody got full, I mean, their bellies was hurting. Oh man. They got all the fish and bread they could eat, son. And then the Bible said they took up 12 baskets full. Is there anything that God cannot do? Sister Wally, the same God did that is the same God that dwells on the inside of you today. Some of you look at me today and say, oh, well, we know that. We know it. You don't exercise it.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Come on.
All right. Go ahead.
All right.
Knowing something's not good unless you put it to work.
Hey, that's the truth.
You can know everything in the world, but if you never do anything with it. And I'm telling you today, there's a God today that says nothing is too hard from him. Hallelujah. A God today, when Peter looked like the boat was sinking, and the Bible said they saw Jesus come walking on the water. And Peter asked him, said, Lord, I didn't mean to come to you. He said, come. Now you can sit back there and say, well, I don't believe that all you want to. But this little short, getting skinny preacher has a... believe with all my heart that Peter began to walk on the water. And when he looked down and saw what was going on, he became afraid. Is there anything God cannot do? Hallelujah. Is there anything today? 10 lepers walking down the road saw Jesus and cried out to Jesus. And Jesus just said, go show yourself to the priest. Oh man, this excites me. And as they walked, they were healed.
Come on.
Although those fingers that was nubbed, the skin came over, all that leprosy stopped, and all they went to the priest. But there was one that come running back. And the Bible said he fell at Jesus' feet.
Yes.
And began to give him thanks and everything. Jesus said, did I not heal 10? Where's the other 9? And he said, go thy way. Thy faith has made you whole. His fingers was restored. Not just flesh put over, but completely restored. There's some of us today, God heals us. But honey, the real healing comes when you go back and say, Lord, I just come back to thank you one more time. I want to praise you again, God, for what you've done, Lord. And the way you bless me, Lord, I want to praise you. 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 Hallelujah. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Anything. One more time. Look at your neighbor and say, is there anything too hard?
Is there anything too hard? All right.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Here you go, brother. Here you go, right here. Hallelujah. Lazarus died, Jesus' friend. And all of a sudden, Jesus shows up 4 days later. And his sisters begin to look at him and said, Master, yeah, I want you to read it for me in a few minutes. Yeah. Some of these preachers, you just got, I don't know, you just got. Oh, but not yet. Hold your mule there, I tell you. Praise God. And Lazarus was dead. They said, Lord, he said, and Jesus said, oh, he's just asleep. But no, Lord, you don't understand. He stinks by now. And Jesus said, no. Well, we know he's going to live with the resurrection. Jesus said, you don't understand. I am the resurrection.
Right.
I am life. He said, I'll tell you what you girls do. Go away with the stone. They roll away the stone. And Jesus said, Lazarus, come forth. I've heard preachers say, if he hadn't said Lazarus, the whole graveyard would have come out. No doubt they would have. But can you imagine, here comes Lazarus.
Yes, sir.
Come on, preacher.
And he said, loosen him. Oh, I wish I could loosen some of you today.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. He came forth from the grave. Is there anything too hard for your God?
Uh-huh.
And I'm saying this morning, and I preach this morning because of what this lady told us. Because I'm going to be there with everything that's within every pound I got. And you know there's a lot of pound there. I'm going to believe with every pound I got that there's nothing God can not do. Some of you right now, listen to me. You're living defeated lives because you will not stand and say, there's nothing my God can't do. There's nothing my God. Some of you got family problems, unreal. Unreal. But there's a God today that says there's nothing that I cannot do. There's nothing I can't work out if you'll give me a chance. There's nothing. If you would just hold on, there's nothing I will not do. I can do anything. Anything. He said, I can do anything but fail today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In 3 days, Jesus said, I'm going to come up from the grave. 3 days after his death at Calvary, he arose from the grave. There's nothing my God can't do. He told them in the book of Luke and Matthew and all the way through, he told them about the day of Pentecost. He said, I'm going to send the Comforter unto you, but go to Jerusalem and tarry there till you be endued with power from high. And they went. Oh my. And the Holy Ghost fell. And God filled them with the Holy Ghost. 120. They spoke in a language they never spoke in before. Hallelujah. They went out into the streets talking in tongues and worshiping and praising, magnified and lifting God up. Oh my. Don't you know that was a great day? Hallelujah. The Bible also talked about that Peter and Paul and Silas was put in prison. And I want you to know, church, that was the inner prison. That wasn't on the outside. It wasn't like you could look outside and see the sunshine. It was the inner prison. Stocks, their feet and hands were clear. They were set and flat.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And at the midnight hour, I don't know about you, but I'd been doing some crying. I'd be doing some grumbling. And some rah, rah, rah. But Paul looked over at Silas, and Silas looked over at Paul, and he said, hey, let's sing. Well, what do you want to sing? Well, what about, I wouldn't take nothing from a journey now. Or, I'll never forget that wonderful hour. At the midnight hour, they begin to sing. And the Bible said that old prison began to shake. It was Presley wasn't the one who had to shake, rattle, and roll. Paul had rattle and roll way from where Elvis Presley ever come on the scene, honey. And that jailhouse began to rock. Hallelujah. Is there anything too hard for your God today? You say that God can't. I tell you, God can do it. God can do it today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God can do it. Peter, his head was supposed to roll the next morning. And I'm fixing to give up the ghost because my wife, that's the last one. When I get that look, I know that's all she wrote done. Peter got to the place. They'd already killed James. They were going to kill Peter the next day. His head was going to roll. But you know what happened? They had a prayer meeting over at Mary's house. Brother Backus was talking about prayer this morning. Prayer can do anything. Because when you begin to pray, you wake God up. When you begin to pray and you begin to worship, God said, I got to go. I got to get in the middle of that. I got to go. I gotta go. And before long, God's right down in the middle of everything today. Is there anything your God cannot do? Anything. Well, Brother Fisher, you just told us a few things about healing. Read now, brother.
And there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written.
The world couldn't contain it. The books that should be written, the miracles that my God done today. He said, these things and greater things shall you do. That means you're going to do more of them than he did, honey. There's nothing my God can't do. Nothing, Brother Newsom. Nothing, Brother Newsom. It's 12 o'clock. I know your stomach's growling, mine is too. So, but there's nothing God can't do, sister. No matter what the situation is, no matter what the problem is, I don't know you, but there's nothing my God can't do. Adolf, there's nothing God can't do, son. My Lord, he can even give you a husband, a wife.
Yes, sir.
Nothing God can't do. Nothing. How many in this building today that you are sick? Would you raise your hand? Oh, I've been preaching to a well group of people today. Woo. How many's got pain? Raise your hand. Oh, raise them high. My goodness alive. You don't mind complaining to everybody about them, don't you? Come on. How many of this building today, you've got a problem. You do have a problem. It may be marriage. It may be children. It may be this. It may be that. But there is a need somewhere. Maybe on the job, whatever. There's a need that you have today. Hallelujah. I want to challenge you this morning. Hallelujah. To look up and tell God. Say, God, your word said. You said it, God. There was nothing, God, that you could not do, God. I don't care how far in depths of sin that you've gone. God, the word lets me know there's nothing God cannot do. There's nothing God cannot deliver you from. No matter what it is. God can do it. I want you to lift your hands as brother. Praise right now. Hallelujah.
Oh, yes, there's nothing too hard for the Lord. Oh, there's nothing too hard for the Lord. He can do what he said he do. There's nothing too hard for the Lord.
Hey, I'm going to tell you, if anybody in this building today, you really want deliverance and you really want God to do something for you. Now look, I'm not talking about just come up here because everybody else is coming or because your neighbors are there. I want somebody that's sincere. I want people to come up here today that you really want God to take care of your problem. And you believe today there's nothing that your God cannot do. If God done it for somebody else, he can do it for you today. There's nothing that my God cannot do. Hallelujah. How many remembers the night you prayed through the Holy Ghost? Oh, the joy, oh, the happiness, the glory that God did. Hallelujah. Man, no, hey, my Lord, you shouted. You said, my God's real. There's nothing my God. Hey, that God's still alive this morning. And he's willing to do something for you right now. If you really got a need, you really want God to take care of it, I challenge you to walk up here today with your hands raised saying, God, there's nothing you can't do. You sit all the way down here, God. There's nothing today that you cannot do. If you come right now, I believe that God will take care of it for you. Let's sing today.
May not have been like the pastor 10 years old, but I thank God that the Lord came into my life. I'm so glad that he filled me with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody in the house is glad you filled with the Holy Ghost?
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Are you glad that you found somebody told you about a man called Jesus, a man named Jesus? Aren't you glad that you found out about Jesus? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. No matter what you hang up or what you were hung up on, come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But you know, I'm so glad that when he filled me, he did it right. Because God always does it right. Hallelujah. And it don't take but one time. One time. One time. When he filled you, every person that's standing here tonight under the sound of my voice, when he filled you with the Holy Ghost, it only took one time. But the thing about it is, hallelujah, you got to keep going to the watering hole. You got to keep going to the well. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. You know, when the Lord fills you with the Holy Ghost, it doesn't stop right there. It doesn't stop right there. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Do you know that you got to feed that spirit? Do you know that you got to feed that spirit? You know, if you don't feed that spirit, it'll dry up on you.
Come on now.
Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. And that's why I always tell you, hallelujah, at my house, since all the kids are gone, I took one of the bedrooms and turned it into a prayer room, to my office, Sister Waddy's office. Hallelujah. See, because I know you got to keep feeding that spirit. You got to keep feeding the church. You got to keep feeding it. Somebody need to hear me. You got to keep feeding it. Because if you don't feed it, hear me tonight. Hear me tonight. Sister Brandon, if you don't mind, put up that starting statement that I gave to you just a few minutes ago. Because if you don't, I want you to read this with me. Hallelujah. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Give me the next verse. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue, having five porches. Doesn't have anything to do what I'm going to preach about tonight. But what I'm getting at about these five porches doesn't have anything to do with what I'm going to bring tonight. But I'm going to tie it in together. And I have a question for each and every one of you that's standing here tonight under the sound of my voice. And I mean it with every breath within me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Five porches. And I have a question. There's the porch of deception. There's a porch of evil and wickedness. There's a porch. Of a conviction. There's a porch of unbelief. There's a porch of holy and righteousness. And I have a question. Which porch are you living on tonight? Which porch are you living on tonight? Are you happy with the porch that you're living on tonight? Have you been on the porch of deception so long until you like where you're at, until you like where you're living, that you done took the porch of deception and you done sat on that porch so long until you just tidied it up, fixed it up, and it looks good to you? Are you living on the porch with evil and wickedness? Hallelujah. Are you living on the porch of addiction? So you have been addicted so long that you want help, don't know how to get help. But I got news for you tonight. You come to the right place. You come to the right place. Hallelujah. 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 Have you been on the porch so long that unbelief have got you tied up, that when the pastor give you a word, you doubt what the pastor say? And then when that thing comes in and bites you, when the pastor tried to give you warning, you come to the right place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You come to the right place simply because this is the place where holiness and righteousness dwells. Give the Lord a hand clap of worship. Give him a hand clap of worship. Give him a hand clap of worship. Hallelujah. 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 You know, church, I asked you earlier, can I speak to you from my heart? But can I tell you the truth? Brother Wilder, just tell you the truth? Can I just tell you the whole truth? I've been on all these porches. I've been on all these porches. The porch of deception, the porches of evilness, wickedness, addiction, unbelief. Until one day, I found out about a man called Jesus. A man named Jesus. And that same Jesus is here. He's here. He's here. Somebody need to hear me tonight. Hallelujah. 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 He's here. See, because one thing that I don't live in a glass house. See, I know everybody in here ain't saved. Everybody in here don't have the Holy Ghost. Everybody in here ain't living right. Yeah. But I know a man that's able and willing. If you want to get off that porch, if you're tired of being on that porch, he'll give you complete deliverance, complete healing. And if you're a saint of God, and if you claim the Holy Ghost, and if you're dealing with some things, if you're battling with some things, he'll give you a complete renewing. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, somebody. You know, hey, y'all can be seated. You know, the Spirit of the Lord has been dealing with me. He's been dealing with me. There's something that's been stewing in me. And I do have a message. And I do have a word. But I want to be obedient. I don't want to give nothing from the flesh, of the flesh. I want it to be right. And I want to let the whole church know before we get into the reading of the word, the opening of the word. I want to let the whole church know, from the top to the bottom, from the front to the back, and everything there in between, that I'm not mad at nobody. I'm not upset with nobody. But it's one thing that I must and I have to do as a saint, I mean as a minister and as a preacher. If the Lord said do it, if the Lord said give it, if the Lord said say it, I'm going to say it. Hallelujah. 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 Let's give the Lord another hand clap of worship. Hallelujah. 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 In fact, I want everybody to stand if you please, if you don't mind. Hallelujah. I think it's been a while, at least since the last time I've been up here. And I want everybody to step out of the aisles, and I want you to step across the aisle and greet one another and just shake your hands and just let your brother and sister, the saint of God, know that you love them, that you care about them, and just tell them that, you know, it's good to see you one more time. It's good to see you one more. I love you too, Pastor. I love you too. Can I go, Pastor?
Go.
Okay. All right. I'm waiting on my help. My help coming. I'm gone.
Touch us tonight, Lord. Lead us by the Holy Ghost.
Yes, sir.
Oh, we want your
will. Yes, Lord. Your will, Jesus.
Change us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Have your way, Holy Ghost. Love you, my brother. God bless you, man. God bless you. God bless you. Have your way, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. I need you one more time. Yes, Lord. Have your way, Master. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Praise your voice tonight, Lord. May we hear your voice tonight. Use your vessel tonight for the glory of God. Anoint this
yes,
man of God like you've never been anointed before. I want you to release this spirit, Lord, to speak, Lord, what the saith the Lord, Lord. Let there be no inhibition, Lord. Let there be nothing holy, man. Remove all the strongholds.
Yes,
we come against doubt and unbelief, Lord. We release faith in this house, right?
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Your precious blood, Jesus, you're worthy, Master. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus, you're worthy, Master. Thank you, Master.
I
love you too. Yes, I do. Hallelujah. All right. Preach with me, okay? All right.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Have your way, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. Your precious blood, Jesus, you're worthy. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Have your way, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. You're worthy, Master. Your blood, Jesus. Your deliverance, Jesus. Your healing, Master. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. Thank you, Master. Have your way, Holy Ghost.
Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Hallelujah.
Have your way, Master. Thank you, Jesus. Your precious blood, Master. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Your precious blood, Jesus. Hallelujah. Your word, Jesus. Your healing power, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Break the spell tonight, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name. Hallelujah. I asked y'all to step across the aisle, but we don't have no family reunion. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord another hand clap of worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Truly, truly, the healer is in the house. Thank you, Master. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name. Thank you, Jesus. If you don't mind, if you have your Bibles, we're going to go to the opening reading of the Word. We're going to the book of Acts. And I just want to preach some truth tonight. Is that all right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. The book of Acts, chapter 8, verse 5. Acts chapter 8, verse 5. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise your wonderful name. I'm going to preach it, Brother Tyrone. Hallelujah. Preach with me, Tyrone. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What I love about Brother Tyrone, he stays the same. Hallelujah. Huh? Huh? I don't care if it's good or bad. He's going to say, thank you, Jesus. Yes, that's what I love about my brother. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In verse 5, it says, then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits crying with loud voices came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies that were lame were healed. And there was great joy in that city. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And to him they had regard, because that of long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. And if you notice right there, church, it says sorceries, which means there was more than one evil and wicked thing going on in that town. Hello, somebody. Hallelujah. I'm going to get back to that in my text. Hallelujah. But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Amen. Then Simon himself believed also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. Now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Right. Then laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Now listen, church. These are the words I want you to observe and pay attention to tonight. Hallelujah. In verse 5, it's going back to verse 5. In verse 5 it says, Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. Can I hear the church say Christ?
Christ.
All right. Let's go down to verse 8. In verse 8 it says, and there was great joy in that city. Can I hear the church say joy?
Joy.
All right. Let's go down to the last verse that we read, which is verse 17. In verse 17 it says, Then laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. Can I hear the church say Holy Ghost?
Holy Ghost.
Now what are we talking about tonight, church? We're talking about Christ, joy, and the Holy Ghost. And that's what I want to talk about tonight. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of worship. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of worship. Christ, joy, and the Holy Ghost. You got to have Christ, you got to have joy, and you sure got to have the Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody, give him a hand clap of worship. Give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Come on, Come on, you can do better than that. Clap them hands. Clap them hands. Clap them hands. Hallelujah. Now you all can be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, in this day and time, I want to know the church to know that it is important that we recommit ourselves to Jesus Christ. We need to recommit to preaching about it, talking about it, demonstrating his life in the workplace, in the home, in the schoolroom, and everywhere else. And not be ashamed to testify about Jesus Christ. You know, in this day and time, it's such a rise of interest in other so-called world religions. And it is so sad, hear me tonight, it's so sad that in a nation like the United States of America, where we used to boast of pretty much of being a Christian nation, everybody didn't embrace the Pentecostal doctrine. But almost everywhere you went, from the White House to the shack out in the country, everybody was lifting up the name of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
But as the population of this nation and the population of the world continues to explode or continue to expand, we in the Christian community have begun to teach and focus on prosperity, upon that particular way that we can use the word in order to enrich our lifestyle. And while we, the Christian community, have gotten caught up in a corner, and thank God for a tent revival, others are invading the minds of the people of this nation and invading the mind of the people that's in the streets into Islam and swept into Scientology. And then you got a very smooth talker that will introduce you to the Book of Mormons, another testament of Jesus Christ. But hear me now. But if you get the word of Jesus Christ down in your heart, you understand that the Lord said, don't you add to this. It's complete by itself. He said, if you add to it, I'll add to you the plagues that are written therein. And if you take away from it, I'll take away your part out of the Book of Life. Hello, somebody. While other religions are trying to compete for the minds of the hurting multitude that are out there in the streets instead of trying to win the sinner. And please hear me tonight, church. If you really, really have spiritual eyes up in here, talking to the saints of God, if you really, really have spiritual eyes up in here tonight, you look behind me and you would see a bunch of fishing poles and rods and reels up in here. Hallelujah. People are not trying to get the people out of the streets. They're trying to reach in here and trying to get those that are already church. And you know I'm telling you the truth. Practically every one of you, somebody has tried to proselyte you. They tell you, honey, what are you doing going down there for? Or what are you doing going down to Peace Tabernacle for? We need your help over here. Come on over here, honey. The Lord is working wonders. And you go there and sit for months and never see the wonders. Hello, somebody. We're living in a day and time where we need to recommit to Jesus Christ. Somebody give the Lord a hand clap of praise and shout that I'm sold out to Jesus. To Jesus. Hallelujah. Now understand now, church. Before Philip went down to the city of Samaria preaching Christ, the city was all messed up. There was a fellow by the name of Simon. Simon the sorcerer. Simon the old conjurer. Simon the necromancer. Simon the charmer. Simon the wizard. Hello, somebody. Simon the palm reader. Simon the crystal ball gazer.
All right.
Simon the hoodooer. Yeah. Simon the male witch. Simon the psychic. Hello, somebody.
Yes.
The whole city was under his control. And the Bible says for a long time he had bewitched them with sorcery. And you know, church, it is something about it when people can be bewitched and think they're on the right track. Hello, somebody. But when Philip went down and preached Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus the anointed one, hallelujah, as he began to preach, the spell was broken. And I'm here tonight to tell you that Jesus will break the spell. It doesn't matter what it is. Jesus will break the spell. You can be so addicted chemically. I don't care what it is. Crack cocaine, heroin, PCP, pill popping. I don't care what it is. Jesus will break the spell. Hallelujah. 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 The Holy Ghost will destroy the yoke. It will destroy the yoke. Hallelujah. He'll lift you. Lift you. Lift you above everything that's going on around you. I don't care how and what it is. Your stuff can be so messed up, it could be like Stephen. Stephen looked up when they were stoning him to death. Hallelujah. So I heard somebody say the outlook was gloomy, but the outlook was glorious. When Stephen looked up, he saw Jesus. Hallelujah. And I just feel like preaching tonight. Hallelujah. And I just come to tell you tonight, I don't know what's going on in your house tonight, but I know Jesus will lift you above that one that's trying to do you in. Hallelujah. Philip preached Christ, and I want you to know tonight, Christ, when you preach Christ, not only are you preaching Jehovah Rapha, but you're preaching salvation for the soul. But automatically, there's a healing that goes along with it. In the book of Isaiah 53:4-5, it says, surely he has borne our grief and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. Yes, he died for our hang-ups. Hallelujah. But he was hung up for our hang-ups. Hallelujah. He was hung up for our hang-ups. Hallelujah. And I want you to know, the church, tonight, church, whatever you're preaching Jehovah Rapha, you're preaching the Lord our physician, you're preaching the Lord our Savior. Lord is able to do anything but fail. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I don't care what it is. What it is. What it is. You know, I've been telling you for the last 3 years, 4 years now, what the Lord has said to me. Some people shake it off. But he told me to tell you tonight, I don't care what it is. I don't care what you have. He told me to tell you, if you got it, he told me to tell you, I can heal it. Right. He said, if you have it, he said, I can heal it. The doctors may not be able to get that thing under control. But he said, if you can have it, he said, I can heal it. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's cancer. I don't care if it's addiction. I don't care what it is. I don't care what point you're living on. He said, if you can have it, he told me to tell you that I can heal it. Hallelujah. 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 Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Hallelujah. You need to tell a neighbor, the neighbor closest to you. You need to tell him, if you can have it, tell him the Lord can heal it. I got a question. Is it anybody in here?
Come on.
Have you been healed?
Yes, sir. Many times.
Is anybody in here? Have you been set free?
Yes, sir.
Is it anybody in here? Have you been delivered? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then you don't need to sit down, but you ought to leap to your feet and shout hallelujah. You ought to leap to your feet and shout hallelujah. 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 There you go. Clap them hands. Clap them hands. Clap them hands. Clap them hands. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. 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 Philip went down to Samaria and preached Christ. You know, and I know sometimes we get excited, but when doctors come, and I know we have a doctor in the house, our first lady. But when doctors come to church, he or she don't come to church to hear me talk about medicine, eyes, ears, or throats.
No, sir.
I don't know anything about medicine. All I know is about medicine is enough for the doctor to know how dumb I am. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. In other words, sometimes people come to church and they get everything except what they come for. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. I don't think anybody come up in here tonight for me to give them lessons on computer technology. I don't know anything about it.
All right.
But I do know a man. I know a man that can save your soul. I know a man that can make you whole. I know a man that can give you complete deliverance. I know a man, hallelujah, will give you complete, total deliverance. Will heal your mind. Hallelujah. Anybody know that man? If you know him, I wish you shout his name. Hallelujah. Give him another hand clap of worship. Hallelujah. 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 Praise your wonderful name, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, we come to church. Come to church. Leave church. Come to church. Leave church. And this ain't even in my notes. Come to church, leave church. And I already told you about the five porches. Come to church, leave church. Service after service. But I want to ask somebody tonight, and I mean it with every breath I breathe. Saint, sinner, friend of mine. Aren't you tired of coming to church Sunday after Sunday, service after service, and leaving the same way you came in? Aren't you tired of packing that weight on your shoulder? Aren't you tired of when you get home, you're mad, you're frustrated, you're tired? Aren't you tired?
Yes.
Hallelujah. But I come to tell you tonight, you don't have to live on that porch no more. You don't have to live on that porch of deception no more. You don't have to live on that porch of addiction no more. You don't have to live on that porch being deceived no more. You don't have to live on that porch no more. Hallelujah. 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 Can I preach like a Philip pastor? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For those that come into church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and you come into church and you pray, and you pray, and you pray, and you pray, and I listen to you when you pray. But if I listen to you, your tongue sounds like your brother's tongue. Hello, somebody. Yeah, I just felt a little spirit of resistance, but I'm going to tell you, your tongue sounds like your brother's tongue. But the Lord told me to tell you tonight what you need to do. What you need to do. You need to go home. If you don't have a prayer closet, you need to go home. Clean that room out. Get in that closet. Make your closet. Build your prayer closet. And if you stay in that closet for about 3 hours, you'll come out. You'll come out of that closet. speaking your own tongue. And I guarantee you, when you come out of that closet speaking your own tongue, it will be edified. It will be edified. Hallelujah. 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 Aren't you tired? Aren't you tired of living on that porch of deception? Are you tired of living on that porch of deception? You say you got the Holy Ghost. You say you got the Holy Ghost. But you can't even live or forgive your sister man. Your sister man. You can't even forgive your sister. Your brother. You can't even forgive him. Aren't you tired of living on that porch? 25 years you've been living on that porch. 25 years you've been living on that porch. Aren't you tired of living on that porch? Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Like I said, I'm not mad at nobody. Hallelujah. But I got the table, thus said the Lord. I told you something has been stirring in me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it's the same. And let me say something. Hallelujah. Some of you, I can walk up to you and put my hands on you. I can put my hands on you. I've been put my hands on you for 2 years now. I can walk up to you and put my hands on you. And tell you a few things about what's happening. I can do it. But I don't do it because that ain't how the Holy Ghost operates. That's not how the Holy Ghost operates, right up here. You got to give it to him. Take it to him. But when are you going to get tired of living on that porch? When are you going to get tired of living on that porch? 25 years, 20 years, you've been living on that porch. Thank you, Pastor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The devil, our adversary. He's out to destroy each and every one, all of us, from the top to the bottom, and everybody and everything there in between. He's out to destroy everything. But hey, you got to wise up. We got to wise up. We got to wise up. You got to wise up. You got to wise up. You got to shake that thing. You got to let it go. You got to let it go. You got to forgive. Hallelujah. 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 You know, the pastor's only one man. The pastor's only one man. And I'm not trying to build him up. I love him. I have to love him. I love him. No, I mean, I love him. I love him. I do. I love my pastor. Hallelujah. Because I'm going to tell you, when the Lord filled me with the Holy Ghost, he did it right. He did it right. I don't care if a brother or sister talk about me and say what you want to say, try to put a stumbling block in my way. You can't do nothing to me. You can't do nothing to me. You can't do nothing with me. You can't hinder me. You can't hinder me. Hallelujah. It can't hinder you neither. Can't hinder you neither. Not only me, can't hinder you. Hallelujah. These 5 years I've been in church, it ain't been always peaches and roses. And this, I've had stumbling blocks. I've had people try to hinder me, but I'm still standing. I'm still standing. I'm still worshiping. I'm still standing. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you, let me share something with you. See, because I didn't ask for this. God, hey, many are called, but few are chosen. And I'm not bragging, I'm not boasting, but I'm one of the few. I'm one of the few. Now, I'm not trying to give you, hear me clearly now. I'm not bragging about, because I know there's other pastors and preachers and evangelists can preach me under the pew. I know this. But that ain't what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, I got love for everybody. I got love for everybody. And I'll keep my spirit right. Keep my heart right. I don't care. Black, white, brown, blue, purple, doesn't matter. Hallelujah. See, when the Lord delivered me, and some of you, we got tired of being on that porch. We got tired of being on that porch. Am I right about it, sisters? We got tired of being on that porch. Tired of being on that porch. Hallelujah. But I just have to tell you, a lot of us are living under the spirit of deception. The spirit of deception. The spirit of deception. I mean that. The spirit of deception. And we got to break that thing. You got to ask the Lord to break that thing. Come on, somebody. For real. For real. Come on. Hallelujah. 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 And I'm going to tell you, it's time out thinking you're going to fake it until you make it. It's all right. Let me tell you, that test is coming. That test is coming. You can only run and fake and shake for a little while. Well, only run as long as the Lord allows you to run. And then that test gonna come. That test gonna come. See, one thing I told you before, if you all remember, I thank God he didn't give me the spirit of being judgmental. I don't judge nobody. Don't judge nobody. Because I can fall just as quick as anybody in here. I can fall. I know I can fall. Hallelujah. I know I can walk out and never walk back in. I know I can. Any reason why I know I can? Hallelujah. Because I done picked up the habit, let it down, picked it up, let it down, picked it up, let it down. So I know it can happen. I know it can happen. But it ain't going to happen. But it ain't going to happen. I can tell you that. It ain't going to happen. Because I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. Yes. Filled with his power. Hallelujah. Filled with his power. God is filled with his power. Is anybody in the house filled with God's anointing power? Is anybody in the house filled with his power? Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Praise your one. You know, I didn't even finish my message. I'm going to get ready because the Spirit of the Lord told me to shut it down, to stop. And I'm going to do what the Spirit told me to do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But I'm also going to tell you what the Spirit told me to say. And I'm going to get up here where I can look at you real good. All right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I asked you before, hallelujah. See, if you don't know this about Brother Waddy, about me, I want to tell you. And Pastor knows that about me. I'm one of them old school nonsense preachers. I don't believe in shucking and jiving. I believe in praise and worship of the Lord. Come on, somebody. I believe when you come into when you walk in them doors right there, it's time out for everything. Don't come to me talking about fishing and hunting and all that. It's, when you step in them two doors, them swinging doors, it's all about God. It's all about Jesus. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. You know I'm telling you the truth. You know I'm telling you the truth. With all that being said, the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord said for me to tell you, anybody, in fact, everybody stand, please, if you don't mind. Everybody standing. Everybody standing, because I'm through. If you're tired, if you're truly, truly tired, as I said before, I know everybody in the house is not filled with the Holy Ghost. Everybody ain't saved. Somebody need to be renewed. Some saints need to be renewed. Some saints need to ask God for forgiveness.
Please.
Some saints of God need to get it right. Hallelujah.
That's right.
Hallelujah. And my sinner friend, aren't you tired of living on that porch that you're living on? Are you tired of living on that porch? You know, the Spirit of the Lord is here. And whatever you desire, whatever you need from the Lord, if you come to the altar with a sincere heart, if you open up your mind, and as you're standing there right now, if you just tell that adversary, tell that devil he's a liar, tell him I'm tired of you deceiving me, I'm tired of living a lie. You had me deceived for 20 years, 10 years, and I'm tired of it, and you're not going to deceive me, not another day, not another minute. I'm going to get what I need from the Lord, and the only way for me to get it, I'm going to the altar, and I'm going to give it up. But Jesus, I need you. I need you, Lord. I need you. I need you. So come on to the altar. 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 Come on to the altar.
Take me back.
Yeah, yes, yes, yes. Hey.
Take me back.